live today, and we have special guests from MB Architecture. We have Maziar, Behrooz, and Bruce Engel. And I met these gentlemen about a year ago when I decided to run for mayor of the village of East Hampton. And they have laid out some wonderful plans to revitalize the village, the park, a whole new concept, which I just love. And so I asked them to come on the show and share it with everybody. They've already shared it with the current village board. They've shared it with the Star. So you might have seen parts of this a couple of years ago or a year ago. So I'm going to introduce, let them introduce themselves, and then they'll get right into their talk. Welcome, everybody.
Hi, Jerry. Hi, Bruce.
Hi, Jerry. Thanks for having us.
Right, ready.
A little background, Jerry. I basically moved out here and completely in 1996. I'd been coming here a little bit before that. And in 96, I pretty much packed everything I had in New York City and moved out to Amagansett and decided that I'm going to become a full-time resident and a practicing architect out here. This was back in 1996 when everyone was doing really large shingle style homes. And here I am, someone who was trained really to kind of be a modernist architect. And I found myself in an interesting position because what I was seeing around me was somewhat different from what I was ready to do. So I took about a year, that first year I came here, to go to the East Hampton Library, the archive room, the Long Island collection, and go through history books of what architects here had been doing since more than 100 years ago. And I would bring my sketchbook and like draw the buildings, the houses, the village plans that had been done way back then. And I remember, this is like a really funny anecdote, seeing this travelogue from someone who'd been here 120 years ago, who was complaining about city people coming out and ruining the East End. So that was basically a start. I really wanted to be in some place that was smaller, that had a more communal feeling. I didn't see a place for myself like chipping away at this giant rock of New York City. And I just, you know, put out my shingles on the first place I was in was next to the old bowling alley across from the Red Horse. And Bruce, the way I met Bruce was really interesting. I was sitting at the farmer's market back then in Amagansett on a bench having a, you know, I don't know, coffee or tea or something. And a lady next to me started talking and she asked me what I did. I said, architecture. She goes, oh, my son's going to architecture school. Where'd you go to school? I said, I went to Cornell. Oh, he's going to. So the next thing I know, Bruce, that summer became my intern. And so I don't know how many years ago that was, but that's how we started working together. And I think it was that first
20
summer,
years ago.
Yeah. 20 years ago when we together submitted a project for an international competition for a $40 million temple at 250 countries. And we were shortlisted as one of four people. And so we had a good start. That was a good start. I didn't get the job. I was very disappointed not to have gotten the job, but we had a really beautiful project and I think I used it to show what we could do, are capable of doing. And so I was living in East Hampton. I built a house for myself back then in 96, eventually in the village of East Hampton. And I lived in the village for many, many, many years until I was founding it like almost like a sleeper community. Like people, like off season, it became so quiet. And now it's even more, now it's quiet in an alienating way. It's like even during the weekend, it's kind of quiet in a weird, not quiet, but it's not a place that I've wanted to continue to necessarily live in. I moved to Sag Harbor. But my office has been on Newtown Lane for now more than 10 years. So that's a very brief intro.
How about you, Bruce?
Maziar said, we basically started working together about 20 years ago, which is crazy to think about. But I grew up out here between the city and out here. My grandparents had built a house in the dunes in Amagansett, in the Peak area in the 50s. When there was basically nothing else around, and my parents bought a house when I was born 42 years ago, and I was coming out ever since. And then it's as soon as I was able, and I lived out here full time in between, and grew up out here, and my formative years were out here, and all my fondest memories were out here. And so I chose to live out here. I live out here with my wife and my two girls, 1 year old and 3.5 year old. We're all quarantined at home. I'm actually at the Newtown Lane office right now just to get a little, so you didn't have all the kids screaming in the background. I love it out here. And, but I've seen through, all the years ever since like hanging out as a little kid, where I was able to, I remember being able to be dropped off, as a little kid in the village and playing with my friends and going to Long Island Sound Records and the various stores and ice cream shops and bookstores and being able to do that stuff. And throughout the years, it's become harder to imagine that possibility for kids and coming to work, every day in the village. It's just seeing the transformation that there just seems to be less and less of what a village, I believe is, a place for people to come together and, entertainment, socialization, and so on. That prompted some of the work that I think we'll get into on this talk. But I love it out here, and I just, want to try to kind of contribute to making it a better place and in many ways kind of restoring it in a way to the ways that a lot of us who have lived out here for a long time remember it and the potential that it has. So Maziar and I have been working on some of these plans that we'll get into today.
Yeah, it's true. As you were talking, I was thinking about growing up, and you're right, there was so many other things to do here. I remember not that long ago, but it was in the 90s, that we had David's Cookies on Main Street. We had the ice cream store.
Yeah,
we had, there was a bar on Newtown Lane, down the end, Crescendo Pub. There was just so many more things. There was later on, there was a restaurant right across from Wallbounds, or Stop and Shop now.
Yeah.
Do you remember that? I forget what it was called, but it was friends of ours owned it, and the Lawickies, and I can't remember the name of the place, but a lot of things have gone by the way. So you just, So anyway, enough of memory lane. It's all gone. So let's see. Let's hear what you have here, because I love it.
Well, the way this came up is basically, how everyone has an opinion about what should happen. Like anyone who lives here, has some ideas about what should happen in East Hampton. What's wrong with it? How to solve the parking problem? And we had been talking about this with almost everyone, all our friends, all the people we work with, like continuously for a long time, and never seeing it addressed, kind of comprehensively. Like, nothing ever changed. Like, maybe at best we got some flowers in the planters on the sidewalk, and nothing ever changed except the large businesses, which are more corporate run, were reinforced to have more spaces and more outlets, which is fine. They can be here, but that kind of I'm not sure, actually I do know how that led in a way tangentially to the reduction of like businesses that were owned by smaller operations. Let's say local operations, mom and pop shops have just been slowly forced out. And so finally we just said, you know, the village isn't hiring a planner, and their comprehensive plan is at the time was 18 years old. We said, you know, we're architects. Let's do something. Let's show, because maybe if we show with graphics what some of these ideas, how we could improve and turn the place into a real community place, not just a tourist destination, maybe they'll like it. Maybe they're going to see that, yeah, this is actually closer to the way the East Hampton used to be, perhaps 30, 40, 50 years ago. And it's time to really just quickly get off this track and jump to the next track and go in that direction. And so we did that one summer. We spent our own summer, like months part-time with our interns, and they developed a whole plan of the village from Main Street to the train station and Gingerbread Lane. And this wasn't like, you know, we talked with a lot of individuals, stakeholders, residents, moms, dads, kids, athletic personnel from the middle school. So we just like, we did what typically planners do. And we came up with some plans on our own. And it was published in the local papers, and we presented to the parish museum and to the town trustees and the mayor a couple of years ago. And following up on that, we kind of zoomed in on Herrick Park. And that coincided with last year when the village decided that they should do something with the village park, with Herrick Park. So we had already developed like initial ideas for it. So our RFQ or our, you know, request, our reply to their, you know, request for information was so much more comprehensive than anything they'd imagined. We just gave them a plan, basically detailed plan at no cost. And I should toot our horn a bit, because that plan won the highest award in the AIA Peconic chapter that it could receive a year later. So it won the highest prize in its category. And it, you know, that jury was comprised of some really, I mean, for me, great professionals. But no, they were really like urban planners, like academics who have a practice, and people who also know this area really well. So we were very happy that that plan was, you know, recognized. And it was a very detailed attempt to show what people in this village have wanted for many years. And we put it online. We have graphics. Perhaps we'll go through that. But that's how this Herrick Park plan started.
Yeah, exactly right. Now, I have a question. What year did you present this to the village? And I remember seeing it in the newspaper, and it was definitely prior to me making a commitment to run.
Oh yeah, it was. I'd like to say it was in 2017.
And when they did.
Yeah, 2017. It was the summer of 2017, yeah. And then that was like the round one, and then we did another round in 2018. Yes. And then after that, we did the detailed plan of Herrick. And it's gone through, obviously, the round one to round two, and Herrick had gone through iterations. But there was always the concept of this kind of village improvement, village revitalization. Yeah.
So you started the process in 2017.
Yeah. And we presented, and it got picked up in the Star, and I think through those means that there was like a little pressure put on the local government to, you know, respond to it. And then they eventually invited us to one of the village board meetings to present, which I think then got picked up on LTV and, you know, heard a lot of good responses from that. Yeah.
Yeah. It's an incredible plan, and a lot of work went into it. And then in 2019, when they put out the RFP, for their renovation of Herrick Park, did you submit this?
So in 2019, they put out finally this RFP asking planners and architects to submit qualifications and ideas. Their RFP, I'm just going to say it, was so inadequate in terms of how it was presented. We tried to bring in, we brought in, besides us, others like landscape planners, people in the like engineering world who knew about septic systems and regenerative environmental people. And no one could really grasp the contents of that RFP. Here they were looking for a massive kind of like undertaking, and basic information was lacking. Like, how much money do you have to spend here? Like, what? How should we design this? Should we design it as though we're changing the fencing around the park and bent putting, or are we? So we took it upon ourselves to make decisions for them. We said, if we just say we're, you know, what? There's nothing else we can do. Let's show to them, and they can then present this to the public, and the public could respond. So use our drawings as a way to gauge what the public wants and then make decisions. So you could use this free service that we've provided and have public meetings, community hearings, and let people react. Let people say, we love it, we hate it, it's this portion should be larger. So here are the tools you would need to conduct this properly. And, you know, so we did that, and we sent them like a good complete documentation, and we did get a single sentence thank you back by email from them. And so then we thought that, oh, so they must have really gotten and picked out like some incredible plan that must put ours to shame. So we just held back until we saw that plan, and done by really great landscape architects. I really don't want to in any way diminish their work. I just want to focus on what we did and say that our work, I feel, really tied itself really well to the community and community needs. And the award that we were then issued or given afterwards, I think what was good to get, I'm not trying to be, you know, just tooting my own horn, but it's nice to see that others will recognize it as being a good plan. So we dealt with all aspects of the park, and hopefully we'll get into that.
Great. Yeah. So we have some people writing in on this. I can see on the side here, we've got people writing in. Just stay with us, because we're gonna blow up the plan on the screen so you can see it better, and then they'll go through it so you can have a better idea. And again, this is a great idea. It was free for the village. You guys spent a ton of time, and I'm sure this would be worth a lot of money on the market. So, you know, to have it as a starting point to then start getting more input, and then we can start changing it to what people want or don't want, it's a great idea. And you got an email. Thank you for submitting. It's great. So go ahead, continue on. I got to take my shots where I can.
Okay. You know, one thing that's coming out of this whole COVID situation is that we have time to reflect. And of course, everyone's talking about that these days. How, where's the silver lining and all that? And I have like moments when I'm like, get really depressed if I think a little too much. And so I try not to think about things that I have no control over. And one of the things that is like Governor Cuomo saying is something like bring back better, or come BBB. It stands for like, let's use this time not just to restore, go back to exactly what we had, but to come up with a better New York. To, you know, and he keeps repeating that. And that thinking like gives me a little hope right now. And it's one of the things I look forward to, that I'm hoping that come June, we don't just like default back to all this kind of like tired thinking about what the village should be. And not to say that we're looking to build casinos in town, but let's turn the village into a place that we all enjoy and we like to go to. And I'd say the people who've served us so far, they've been given a chance to show what their ideas are, and they've had about a decade to act on those ideas and guide our village. And I think it's time for them to graciously bow out and let new ideas come to the forefront and completely change this kind of gridlock. And, you know, what I like about your position always is that you point at the wall and talk about how to climb over it. And so you're always looking for a way to get overcome roadblocks. And what I get from the current kind of like administration is, oh, but we can't do it because of this. Right. And so they just like show walls to you, and it's so easy to overcome them.
Yeah.
So anyway, I hope I'm not digressing too much, but we can zoom into the plans if you like. Or
yeah, why don't we zoom in?
So I'll just say this, and maybe Bruce can comment. The Herrick Park clearly is both an athletic park and a recreational park. You know, so the larger portion of it is used by the middle school, and we spoke with the athletic personnel in the school and asked them what they really wanted to see, and we'll talk about how this new plan kind of reflects those ideas, including moving the tennis court up, which I realized that was also done by the plans later submitted to the village by someone else. So, but then the main thing is, how do you get people to come into the park if they're not there to, say, play football or baseball? Or how do people come in there? And if we go to the next plan, next image, I think it shows the kind of the heart of our project was to, yeah, that plan, if we could blow that up. So Jerry, the upper portion of that plan is Newtown Lane. Okay. And you will see that we kind of reinforced the pathway that's directly across the middle school, and using kind of brick to line up a pathway through the park, through that initial entry on Newtown Lane, to what would become a kind of central place in the park from which you could see the athletic fields, you could see the other side of the park, you could see Newtown Lane, you could kind of have a panoramic view of the park. It was a way to energize the park, and we thought we would take that concession stand that's there now. I mean, it's not, I'm sorry, a shed that's there now, spend about $20,000 just making it, you know, more reinforce it, and turn it into a really small concession stand. Like if summertime somebody wants to roll an ice cream cart and stand in front of it and sell ice cream, great, let him do that. If you're just going to sell water and sodas, I mean, I'm not talking about a cafe, but just a small concession stand that moms and dads are there with their kids who are using the playground. Well, great, I can sit at the benches under this magnificent oak tree, get myself a bottle of water or maybe tea or what, and sit there and enjoy myself. So that lacks currently in Herrick Park, and I believe it lacks in the plans that the village has even received up to this date. So it is what we call energize the park, and we're doing it in a very subtle way. It's not like a big brush stroke, it's just a small step. So you bring people out, and from there you can watch a game if you want to. You can watch your kids in a playground. We even have like a what we call a butterfly garden for kids. It was Bruce's daughter's idea. And on Newtown Lane itself, lack of food options. Why are we not allowing a food truck? And I have a picture of like a small food truck on the screen. I'm not talking about a massive food truck with like just a small food truck with certain, you know, limited number of fares that you can just get. And we created that portion right on Newtown Lane of a paved area. You could get your whatever food you have and sit down with your friends. Another place to kind of congregate, hang out, have an exchange with the community. So this became one side of our plan, and I'll let Bruce comment on anything else that he.
I think you touched on a lot of the major points, and kind of to zoom out on the concept of the park too, which is, I think there was a little bit of a shortfall in also the kind of proposal on the way the village was addressing the park. And I feel like that we had the benefit of addressing the larger village plans that we had looked into, that we were looking at the village as a whole. And when I say the village as a whole, like the downtown commercial zone, kind of generally speaking from Main Street all the way down, you know, to Gingerbread Lane, past Railroad Avenue, that the park itself is a key urban, like piece of urban context to the village. It's an important link between the Main Street area with kind of like the high end stores, and this potential for the village to expand along Newtown Lane towards, you know, where the train station is and Mary's Marvelous and Riverhead Building and a few of these other Fresno and the liquor store and so on, that there's another kind of village. It almost feels like there's two parts of it. So the location of the park is kind of at this key linking point between the Main Street area and the Railroad Avenue area. And I think a lot of people in the village, like especially people who visit and are not year-rounders, maybe like, you know, they do the shopping along Main Street and Newtown Lane, and they kind of hit the Stop and Shop and the park, and it kind of feels like, all right, there's a break in the urban fabric between the two. So we thought of the park as urban fabric. And so I think some of these points, the concession stand and the food trucks that Maziar is pointing out, it's a way to almost kind of like, you know, face the fact like sometimes spending money or going to a place or like purchasing something or consuming something is a way to activate space. And so if you were walking down Main Street away or down Newtown Avenue away from Main Street, and, you know, there's already a break kind of in the fabric where you have the parking lot for Stop and Shop. But if you saw a couple food trucks parked just a little further there, you know, it would kind of, rather than making a U-turn and going back the other way, you'd be like, oh, okay, there's something there. Then you arrive for the food truck, which could rotate throughout the season. You could have seasonal things on and off season that address the seasonal nature of East Hampton. And then you arrive there, and then further into the park, you see other activities like the concession stand that's deeper into the park. So it's a way of pulling people to the park, into the park, and also even encouraging people to walk beyond the park. To walk to the bookstore, to the gallery, then to, you know, Whitmore's, and then to Mary's Marvelous, and so on. So beyond the park itself, like we, by living here and working on the larger village plan, it is an essential piece of the urban fabric. So we treated it both as, you know, important green space and park for recreation, but also like a key linking piece of urban fabric between the kind of Main Street area and this other village you know, down by Railroad Avenue that we feel has a lot of potential that is elaborated more on in our larger village plan. So.
I really think Bruce is so right that the park is like a link between what's on the Main Street side of Newtown Lane and the Railroad Avenue side of Newtown Lane. And urbanistically speaking, you can't just focus all your attention on Main Street. You have to allow density to slowly shift along Newtown Lane towards Railroad Avenue and the train station, and allow that to become a kind of a secondary hub where things and people who can't afford being on Main Street, as it has been happening for the past 5 or 6 years, small shops, lower rent operations, artists, you know, workshops and things like that could occur on that end. And the park becomes this amazing link that lets you hop over and continue. And the same way you connect Newtown Lane through the, you know, by walking by the park, on the opposite side, the park has the same role of connecting Rudershin to long-term parking.
Right.
And
well, you have to stop pretending that somehow we're not living in a wealthy community and that these stores somehow on Main Street are just going to go away and mom and pop stores are going to come back. That's not going to happen. Or right. that some magically you're going to create affordable housing above these stores now. Those days, in my opinion, are gone. Right. You have to expand, like you're saying, into the Railroad Avenue section. And I want to go even a little bit further, and I'd like to take one of those lumber yards up there when they become for sale, like one is now, and make that in a rent-controlled businesses with workforce housing above it. And then you could always control the rents for those mom-and-pop businesses. So, because if you don't, I think eventually that area would become like Main Street again, and you're going to keep eventually putting yourself out of business, if you will.
Absolutely. So, absolutely. Jerry, I think if the village and the town, and this really needs someone proactive, could get together and say, RBS doesn't like its trucks, 18-wheelers, to navigate around Gingerbread and Newtown Lane, and every time they have a delivery to go through that kind of traffic. I bet they, if they were given the friendly kind of opportunity to move out of that particular location to a place that works better for them, that they could, you know, move out there, and then the space across the train station becomes an incredible secondary hub that all locals would use, whether now you want to have a daycare center for right. kids to be dropped off, or, you know, whatever else that you can't afford.
Shoe repair.
The
car. So remember, you'd also.
Basic things, yeah.
You would also have families living right there. You'd automatically have the start of a village.
Yeah, and it's also like.
Sorry, go ahead, Bruce.
No, there's a nice kind of the location of that, besides like being the entryway, like when you come on the train, like the first thing you're confronted with is, you know, a lumber yard. Imagine if it was like this kind of, you know, a visitor center and a nice downtown where you could get your all kinds of goods. But it's also nicely located, kind of triangulated between the lower school, the middle school, and the high school. And, you know, and kids kind of walk through these areas. And imagine if like that could be a place, I mean, really, the only place for kids now is Starbucks, which is kind of crazy for me, or, you know, or maybe the park with its limited amenities. But if there was a place where they could have, and also there's the YMCA there. So there's this real potential for triangulated between all the schools and a place for kids to be, you know, small businesses, people to get out of their cars and do errands while their kids, you know, are entertained or enjoy various shops. And all this could happen in that one place and a way of kind of encouraging foot traffic in that area.
Yeah. And that one lumber yard, well, it was a lumber yard when I was a kid, but now it's basically a storage facility for Ben Kropinski's old business.
Right.
But that, my understanding is that whole land, all that land there is for sale. So you could do something pretty
really great
soon, yeah. you know, so not waiting for Riverhead Building to go.
Right. You know, there's many things you could do right now.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah. So you just got to have the idea.
The land all through that area, all the way to Gingerbread, there's a lot of underutilized area there,
exactly.
considering it's kind of in the heart of the village footprint.
And I don't think you would get much argument from the people who live on Pleasant Lane, because their backyards are looking at that mess that's there now. So you could definitely make that more attractive for them as well.
Right.
And not have it be a parking lot right behind their backyards.
Right.
And you know, so, Jerry, the way, like, one of the things that we should always, like, typically do is not come up with a knee-jerk idea about one piece of land or one property and just buy that and turn.
Right.
We need to see what the whole puzzle looks like.
And exactly.
So we need like a village plan, a vision plan.
Right.
A vision plan that shows like, if we take these steps, this is what it would look like in 2 years, in 5 years, in 10 years, in 50 years. We need that before we can gauge how good any of these ideas are.
Well, it's funny you say that, and you brought it up earlier that the village comprehensive plan is outdated. I mean, it was supposed to have been updated 10 years ago, yeah. And they never bothered. And now it's coming up. The next administration, whoever that is, it's going to fall on them to get it done.
Yeah.
And we don't even know what our community, where we want to go.
Yeah, let's have some public meetings.
We're still going in the direction of that old plan, and we don't even know if it's right.
Yeah. So because it's already been 40 minutes, and I just want to make sure we hit all the main points of this Herrick Park plan, let's zoom into this second image, which is the athletic side of Herrick Park. So you guys will notice that the tennis court, we said it really must move up towards back of the Stop and Shop parking lot, because by doing that, you create a continuous and straight pathway between one parking lot, the short term, to the long term. And that's important to have. Like, you have to do that in order to ease kind of access. I mean, we work in the village. We do this walk every day. And, you know, I worry about some people's nighttime, when it's dark in February and they're making this walk. So we need to make that a nice, paved, brick-paved walkway, maybe with a bike path next to it. And if it's even wide enough, summertime, you could have one of these tiny, small electric shuttles zoom back and forth between Rudershin and long term, instead of like going all the way around, like from, to Newtown Lane and getting caught in traffic, making the whole point of that shuttle moot. So that's one thing. We moved the tennis court up. One thing we did, football players and soccer players would like this, regulation size football field, which we don't have now. So we expanded it. It's a regulation size football field. We located the softball and baseball fields in ways that considered like sun orientation in the batter's eyes and things like that. But beyond that, now if you're sitting at the kind of the concession stand central kind of hub of the park, you can just sit there and enjoy watching a game. And so the athletic side is woven into the more like recreational side, and not disjointed. It's not like two different parks living side by side, but it's the overlap of these two parks, which brings vitality to the park. So on that edge, and I'm gonna let Bruce talk about the edge to the Rudershin parking lot, which is also, we have some cool ideas about that. If you wanna go to the next image, Marcos, or Jerry.
Yeah, so this is the Rudershin edge of the park, the side that faces the diner and the parking lot there. And we thought of a way to kind of, also bring in more business, an idea in general to like bring people to the village, to get them out of their cars, to engage with activities, and then hopefully that engages in all the other businesses. So one idea is to have a covered canopy that could be a solar canopy for maybe on the high season, it's just covered parking spots. And then maybe on the off season or on certain days of the week, it could be a farmer's market. So rather than the farmer's market that's at Nick and Tony's, that's outside of the core of the village where there's nothing else really there. People drive there, get out of the cars, shop at the farmer's market, get back in their cars and go. Again, just to reinforce the idea, if it was here, you drive, get out of your car, go to the farmer's market, then maybe you would walk across the street and get a cup of coffee or go to the bookstore or enjoy the park. So it's kind of like, again, this linking of activities that make a village where people are out and about, whether they're socializing or, there's commercial activity, social activity. So all along the edge of the park, the Rudershin parking lot area, that we also considered how it would be restriped and creating safer ways to cross, for example, from Newtown Lane across to the corner of the park near the Stop and Shop location. You know, we could pave that in a brick paving to really indicate that this is a pedestrian access way. Crossing there from now from Fiero's pizza place to the edge of the park is like kind of no man's land. It's a really dangerous place to cross. And then creating multiple access points. Right now, the only access point is through public toilets, which is kind of strange. And so, you know, a direct access point right at the corner where you could access the tennis courts and go straight to the playgrounds rather than having to loop down through the public toilets. There would still be an access point through the toilets. And then the this covered parking area that could act as a farmer's market down by the softball field would be a little bit enlarged, embellished, and people could tailgate park right up to a game. So especially the very popular writers, artists game, imagine, you know, a bunch of tailgaters there and cookout and the community gathering and watching a game right there. It's just another way of, again, engaging the edge of the park, but making it a kind of urban move to bring people together. And as Maziar was saying, again, with the other playing fields, all these edges were considered for that. And they were placed, all the playing fields were placed in such a way to really allow people to come and enjoy and view a game, not just participate in a game. And I think that's where the concession stand, again, in the middle of the park plays into that, where, you know, it would really support bringing sports back into the park, which I know there's a history of that that's kind of now dissipated. But, you know, if there's a place to get popcorn and candy and soda at a game, like, I think it would just reinforce this place where people come. It just seems in general, again, just to take a step back, the park right now just seems so underutilized. And I think it's because of some of these reasons.
Yeah, I agree with you. And then we were even talking about this off camera that, you know, that's great for the summer. Then what do we do in the winter? You talk about underutilized. There's nothing going on in that park. And Adam Miller actually gave me an idea about covering the tennis courts in the winter and making a small ice skating rink there that families could use. And that would work great with your concession stand because nothing better than some hot chocolate.
Yeah.
But make it really family friendly and fun.
Yeah.
I mean, that should be the goal.
And, you know, people talk about like there's a comment from someone and who says, what about traffic? Absolutely. It's a problem. Traffic is an issue. But we've hired traffic consultants and we've spoken with these consultants who know how to resolve traffic issues, and they constantly tell us you don't solve traffic by just buying more parking space. You kind of have to organize the way the flow patterns of cars, and we found out, as Jerry, you led this and you know very well, that simply by restriping, spending I don't know how much money, a few thousand, I mean whatever, 10 grand or something, restriping all the parking spots in Rudershin and on Newtown Lane, I think we came up with
73 spots.
73 spots that cost nearly nothing.
Right.
So it's just a question of thinking. That's all. Just think a little ahead. So traffic would be solved like that. And if we could just go to the next image so we have some pretty graphics on the screen. And jumping back to the Newtown Lane side of the park. Right now, as soon as you approach the park, and Bruce knows this really well because he brings his dog to our office some days, and big signs, no dogs allowed. So why not have like just a small place where if you have a dog, you can still use the park. You can come to the park, put your dog in that, and you see that small area on the upper left of the image right now. It's just a tiny place for like dogs to hang out and play while you yourself, dog owner, can go to the park. And then we've shown the, you know, how the playground is kind of reorganized with new things. and then where the butterfly garden is, and maybe we can go back to the overall Herrick Park plan image and really kind of wrap up if there's any questions that anyone might have.
I think the I read somewhere, I don't know if it was a comment someone made or I read it in one of the articles, but you know, like one of the key parts of the Herrick design RFP too is, you know, like considering safety, and you mentioned that, Maziar, like walking back and forth from the long-term parking to the village. And someone pointed out, they're like, you know, actually like dog walkers are actually like a key component for like just kind of informal surveillance. You know, there are people who use the park a lot and come. And I know the reasons why there's kind of no dog walking. You know, you don't want dog, you know, do all over the place where the kids are playing. But I think there's a way to control that and create zones for it, that it could still work both ways. And yeah, you know, and to have the dog run near the playground, I mean, you have your dog in the car and you have your kids and you want to go to the playground. So then in the summer, does the dog just stay in the car, but you feel bad about that? So then, you know, if there was just a place where, you know, like say a family could come play with the playground on the kids, the dog could run the dog run, the kids get cranky, you get a couple snacks from the concession stand, you know, and everyone's happy, to my mind. Yeah, I think it's the concession stand, again, just going back to the fact, because it's in the center of the park, and it's kind of, I think, a new idea to the concept of the park.
I think it's a great idea. I think the dog idea should be explored more, because like you said, it's a different age with dogs. I mean, it brings up a funny story. At the last board meeting, one of the board members suggested that they enact a law within the village to clean up after your dog when it does its business. And Barbara Borsak, who's running against me, told him that, you know, we don't have a leash law. So how would we enforce that if we don't have a leash law? And I was driving around the other day and I was thinking about it, you know, back in the 80s, I do remember dogs wandering around by themselves, but can you, anybody out there, tell me the last time you saw a dog all by himself walking around the village? I would just like to know if I'm off, but I don't think anybody lets their dog wander by itself. Everybody either has it under control if you have a really obedient dog, or you have it on a leash.
Yeah. Right.
So moving that concept into the park, I don't see why we couldn't allow dogs to enter the park as long as people were going to be thoughtful and clean.
I mean, so even if you, like, by the way, like, so we presented all these ideas, including this, let's have a public hearing and let's see if our ideas are terrible.
Or maybe we don't even have to call it a hearing. We can have a presentation.
Let's like let the community give input. I mean,
right.
You're not a king or queen.
Yeah.
And right. Just because you live in East Hampton and you've lived here for all your life doesn't make you an urban planner.
Right.
You know, there's a whole study of that, and people who can project what problems we might encounter and how to solve for those problems. So we're in that, we just lack that conversation.
Right.
And I think even beyond lacking the conversation, I think it goes to the heart of the misconception of what a village is and should be by the current administration. I remember when we presented these, the larger plans, the village plans, to the village board back in 2017. And Barbara Borsak on the board, I remember her comment, one of her responses was, but the village, it's not a place for everyone into the town to just come and descend on the village, and a place for everyone in the town to take advantage of. The village is for the village, and the town people, they have their places. They need to take care of their own places, the places to go. And it just like hit me. I was like, wow, that's, you totally miss the concept of what a village is. By definition, a village is a place for the greater population to come together for social, commercial, educational, cultural activities. And by having a mindset, and this is someone who's running against you, to have a mindset that that's not what a village should be, It's like, no matter how much they dress up the improvements, if your concept of what a village should be is completely that misses the mark of what a village is by definition and what it has to be for the people in the greater community, then I think you're like, you're flawed from the beginning. You kind of almost have no chance to making the right decisions, no matter what kind of proposals come your way.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. I was talking to you off air, but I'm not going to get into it right now. We're going to save it for another show, but some of the emails that she has been sending out or her party has been sending out are so divisive between the part-time residents, between the town residents, that the town residents somehow have this motive that they want to come in and just abuse our village and then run back home. I mean, yeah. Like I said, we'll save that for another show. This has been great. Do we want to open it up? Anybody have any questions out there? Please write in. I think people would be responsible with their dogs. I think we have a little delay too on the questions. But I like that comment.
I'm going to share this to my Facebook page later on, and hopefully people will comment and just get engaged. Get engaged. This is the chance to look. If you've been happy, if you think the past 10 years have been an incredible kind of, let's say, village improvement, a village has improved over the past 10 years, and you love what East Hampton has become, then you know who to vote for. But if you feel that that's not the case, and that really there's major gaps in our thinking about what a village is, I think it's time to bring new blood in and test different ideas out.
And you mean me, right?
Yes, I do mean you.
Just joking. You guys have been great.
Thank you.
I love this.
Thanks for having me.
Great concept. And this is the kind of thinking we need. Whether it comes together or whether we have to scale it down a little, but these are the things we need to be talking about. We need to be looking at for the next 20, 30 years ahead of us.
Absolutely.
So we don't leave a mess for our kids and our grandkids, if they're even still here. But thanks again for coming on.
Pleasure. Thank you for having us.
Thanks, Gary. Thanks a lot for putting this together. Appreciate it.
Great to see you.
Good to see you. Bye. Stay healthy.
Thank you. You too.
Thanks. Bye.